If everybody could take their seats so we may begin. Good morning, and thank you for joining us for, I do not know which day this is of public budget hearings. Doesn't matter at this point what day it is. We're here this morning with the Department of State for their budget hearing. So before we get started, Mr. Secretary, if you and all of the testifiers would please stand so we can swear you all in. Please raise your right hand. Do you swear that the testimony that you're about to give is the truth, the whole truth, so help you God?
It is.
Good. Thank you so much. You may be seated. Chairman Grove, do you have any opening comments?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This body has moved, General Assembly has moved a lot of election issues over the years. I know there is a great interest in all four caucuses and the governor to do election changes moving forward. I just want to say I'm looking forward to working with the administration, the House Democrats, my colleagues, the Senate, to improve our election system for every voter, to make sure they have access, it's secure, and modernization. You know, we had the Department of Education Secretary in here. We have a school code from 1949. We have election code from 1937. So getting these things updated, I think, will benefit everyone moving forward. So I look forward to working with you and your team to make sure that happens. And, you know, we got a presidential election. I'd rather be Florida. Thank you.
We thank the gentleman for his opening comments. Mr. Secretary and testifiers in front of you, there's a black box. It is currently red. Each of our members who wishes to ask questions will have 5 minutes to do so, and in that 5 minutes, you will have time to answer those questions. When that light turns green to yellow, that means that there's 30 seconds left in that 5 minute time period. When it turns red, that means that the time has expired. We would ask if you are speaking and the light turns red, that you would use the next 10 to 15 seconds, some people use minutes, but seconds to conclude your comments. Our goal is to get as many members, give as many members the opportunity to ask questions as possible. And with that, Mr. Secretary, if you could start by introducing all of your staffers that are here with you, and then you have time to provide an opening statement. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Al Schmidt. I'm Acting Secretary of the Commonwealth at the Department of State. I'm joined here this morning by, to my left, Jonathan Marks, who's Deputy Secretary for Elections and Commissions, Kim Mattis, who is our Director of Bureau of Finance and Operations. To my right is Deputy Secretary Kalonji Johnson for Regulatory Programs, and to his right is Ariane Claggett, Acting Commissioner at the Bureau of Professional and Occupational Affairs. Again, Mr. Chairman, thank you for the opportunity to be here, and thank you, Chairman Grove and distinguished members of the House Appropriations Committee for the opportunity to answer your questions this morning about the governor's proposed 23-24 budget for the Pennsylvania Department of State. As you know, our responsibilities are at Department of State are significant, and they are varied. These responsibilities are carried out by the Bureau of Elections and Commissions, the Bureau of Regulatory Affairs, which includes the Bureau of Corporations and Charitable Organizations, the Bureau of Professional and Occupational Affairs. We also have the Bureau of Enforcement and Investigations and the State Athletic Commission. So there's a broad variety of different things the Department of State is involved with, and all are critically important. These bureaus, just very briefly, promote the integrity of the electoral process. They provide the initial infrastructure for economic development through corporate organizations and transactions, and perhaps most importantly, protect the health and safety of the public. I look forward to working with the General Assembly to advance this important mission And we're grateful for the opportunity to answer whatever questions you might have today. Thank you.
We thank you, Mr. Secretary. And Representative Kutz, you are first.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Secretary, for being here. It's a pleasure. I want to jump right in to the GGO appropriation. Governor's proposed budget increases $5.3 million, or an 86.7% increase in the GGO appropriation during a time when uncertain economic conditions remain. Within your budget submission, you request $4 million for additional voter outreach. Now, the process to register to vote now is thankfully very, very simple and is easy for folks to figure out. I'm curious, how much funding is the administration now requesting, and can you confirm that this appropriation of $4 million will be spent fairly and transparently across the Commonwealth?
Let me begin by saying, you know, as a former election administrator, just as every vote is precious to me, as a former federal performance auditor, every taxpayer dollar is precious to me. So whatever is included in this budget, I know that we've included out of necessity. I don't follow the $4 million that you mentioned. The $4 million mentioned is not included in this budget, to my understanding.
Okay, so the governor's request then had a $4 million request for additional voter outreach. Is there an appropriation in your request for additional voter outreach?
There is, within this budget, not a request for $4 million in voter outreach.
Okay.
There are increases that we are proposing as part of other responsibilities
sure.
that we have,
but not voter outreach. Aside from the voter outreach, then, it still remains our request that we received was 5.3 additional for GGO, 86.7%. What drives that percentage year over year? That's
right.
That's an awful big increase for us to see.
There are a couple of significant drivers. One is, as we replace the PALS system, which is the system that the Bureau of Professional and Occupational Affairs uses, the infrastructure with that is also shared by our notaries unit. So as that system gets replaced, we also have to stand up a new system for notaries. So that's one of the drivers. Another driver is, salaries and compensation for our already authorized complement that isn't or wasn't otherwise funded. So we have an authorized complement with vacancies that we have not yet filled because there haven't been the dollars to fill those vacancies. There are other expenses as well. Litigation is another one. As you know, over the past several years, the cost of litigation, both at the state level and the county level, has increased significantly. So this is an attempt to budget for that.
Let me dive into that for a second. So I'm curious, would you mind clarifying the department's position now on undated ballots, your guidance?
The Pennsylvania Supreme Court was clear in their recent decision that ballots not hand-dated by the voter should be separated or segregated by the county election officials and not counted.
Right, thank you. So I ask because litigation costs obviously is something that we have to consider in a budget. That's been one source of contention. And what we want to do as legislators is to provide an election system where we have uniformity across the entire Commonwealth. I think you would agree equity, uniformity is important. Would you not?
Yes, it's critically important, and one, I think, important role the Department of State has to help promote and ensure that uniformity. Every county operates under the same election code. As old as that election code might be, every county has to follow the same laws when administering elections. So the more uniform it is, the more every voter's vote is counted the same way in every county.
I couldn't agree with you more. I think, you know, the United States Supreme Court says something similar. I mean, one person, one vote. We want to make sure that is a principle we carry on. And I serve on the Election Law Advisory Board with Deputy Secretary Marks, and we've had so many conversations about the importance of uniformity. So I appreciate your efforts to make sure that guidance is uniform across all 67 counties. It's troubling to me when one or two counties granted, your guidance is a recommendation, but one or two counties kind of stray from that and sacrifice that uniformity that we all desire. So I'm just hoping I can count on your department to help ensure that equity and uniformity across all 67 counties is at the forefront of your policy moving forward.
And I do agree that it is an important role that guidance plays, and you know, every bit as important is that guidance is provided in a timely way, but as far enough before any election as possible, so election administrators know how to administer the election, and voters know well in advance what the rules are that they should follow.
Outstanding. I sincerely appreciate that. I look forward to working with all of your staff. I see my time has expired. Chairman, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank the gentleman, Representative Abney.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Acting Secretary. Good to see you, Deputy Secretary Marks, again. Thank you for your continued commitment to the department, as also your continued commitment to our voters. So last year, under Act 88, we put in $45 million for election integrity grants and funding for our counties. We saw all but four counties, I believe, actually applied for it. So 63 counties applied and got funding. Have you all done any, whether formal or anecdotally, any sort of surveying of those counties in terms of did they find having that additional money to be of value to them in last year's election?
We know from interacting with the counties as we do, and Deputy Secretary Marks has a weekly meeting with county administrators, how important those resources have been to administering elections in those counties. Those resources help pay for making sure that polling places are staffed, making sure that the necessary ballots and equipment are acquired, and all the rest. That grant program, as you know, is operated by DCED. Mm-hmm. So we interact with DCED about that program, and the counties report to DCED with what they've done with those taxpayer dollars.
Awesome, thank you. And so of the millions of votes that were cast last November, either in person or early by mail, were there any major alarming sort of red flags that you saw outside of the traditional, you know, election day polls may open a little bit late or they may be run short on paper or something like that?
And you're right, you do see election after election, a lot of the same problems occurring over time. One problem that I am very mindful of that is worsening is the loss of experienced election administrators at the county level. Elections have changed a lot in the last few years. So many counties have new election systems, in-person voting on election day. Mail-in ballot voting is also very new and very complex for election administrators, not just to operate, but make sure it's interfacing with the in-person voting system so you don't have a vote being cast at a polling place and by mail by the same voter. So it's become much more complicated than it had been in the past. I think the election environment has changed a lot as well in terms of just sort of tension surrounding it. And we've lost a lot of election administrators throughout the Commonwealth. And I think it's important that we do what we can at Department of State to help provide resources to provide either guidance or training materials or anything else like that for them to rely on. Because with so many new people moving into these positions, it makes it more likely, with the loss of institutional memory, that mistakes will occur.
Awesome, thank you. So, I agree. Our poll workers are our front lines elections administrators and you know, our first line of defense when it comes to our elections. So I'm grateful that you mentioned that. So it's good to hear millions of votes cast, not too many, any real major red flags. Our elections officials in our counties saw a net positive impact. And a lot of that had to do with the, you know, actually funding our elections. So it's good to know that. I want to ask you a quick question about staffing. We know that in Pennsylvania, we have an election basically every 6 months. And we know that once an election ends, you really don't have time to really rest on your laurels, and you got to prepare for the next one. Can you talk about the importance of, I know in your elections and commissions department, there's about 35% vacancy. Can you talk about the importance of hiring and filling those vacancies and being fully staffed, not just for the upcoming election in May or in November, but we are just about a year over from a major 2024 primary election. And actually having staff now to build that institutional knowledge that you mentioned can be invaluable to you all. So can you talk a little bit about the importance of having staff now in preparation for the upcoming elections?
Yes, sir. And you know, you mentioned that it is a 365-day-a-year job. When I first became city commissioner, I remember being responsible for running elections in Philadelphia. I remember people saying, what do you do the other 363 days of the year when you're not involved with elections? But there's so much work that goes into running elections in preparation for them and after them, and preparing for the next one as well. We face vacancies in this department in elections, just as the counties do as well, and are working to fill those vacancies with experienced election, or people with experience in the election space, or by their education or other background. It's important that those things get addressed in cycles like this one, and the cycles in like 2025, presidential election years with higher turnout, higher activity, higher just work tempo, gives you very little time to do the sort of long-term structural human resources work that you need to do. So it's times like this that work is best done.
Thank you, and I just want to say I support you all's request for funding. I would say that you can easily justify asking for more money, and I would be supportive of that as well. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank the gentleman. Representative Mihalik.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Secretary, for being here today. It was mentioned earlier about the old election code, and I think it's one thing to operate off of an old law, but a wholly different thing to operate off of an old IT system. So I want to talk about SURE, the Statewide Uniform Registry of Electors. There's a requested increase in your budget materials. Could you talk about that for a moment and what the money would actually be used for?
Sure. The SURE system, as you know, has been around for nearly 20 years. It was not designed for the purpose that it's currently being used for. When it was designed, we had only in-person voting on Election Day, plus, you know, a small number of absentees and alternative ballots and all the rest. With the addition of mail-in ballot voting as well, SURE would need to be replaced regardless because it's 20 years old. I can't even imagine having a phone. I don't even know that I had a phone 20 years ago, let alone a system that would be compatible with right now. So there is a need to replace the SURE system. We've been working with a vendor. We received the first sort of prototype of that, or not prototype, but the first edition of that system that we are having the counties test, so that they can let us know what bugs they find or how we can make it more user-friendly. Because at the end of the day, we manage SURE, but it's the counties that have to work with SURE every day, processing mail-in ballot applications, processing voter registrations, and all the rest. So the counties are providing feedback to us.
So the increased request in your budget materials, is that for the old SURE system? You're mentioning you're working with a vendor to implement a new system, which I believe was at the cost of $20 million, and it was supposed to be, the first phase was supposed to be completed last year. So I want to know, what is the increased proposed funding going to be used for? Is it new or old? And then where are we on this first phase?
Well, the structure of that system with SURE replacement is we only pay sort of as deliverables arrive. And we can, like I mentioned, have the counties test them. I'd like to ask Deputy Secretary Marks to add some more background on the SURE system.
Sure.
And I may actually, if you don't mind, I may refer to Ms. Mattis to give some more details about the actual budget requests. But we are, as Secretary mentioned, we got the first iteration of the SURE vote system in December, mid-December. Our staff analyzed that. We then turned it over to 23 counties to analyze it. I do think there are some increases related to maintenance of the current system. We are the last agency that's using the Commonwealth County Network, for example, so we are paying for 100% of the maintenance of that until we move forward with the new system.
So but I guess my concern is the implementation part of it. Are there benchmarks? Like, when is it going to be implemented? Because we have a presidential election next year, and I just fear what that might look like if we're implementing a new SURE system in a presidential election year. So what is being done by the Department of State working with the vendor to ensure that it's implemented in a municipal year and not in a presidential year?
Well, we will work with the counties to make sure that when we do implement it, it's done and it's ready, not just from our perspective, but from the county's perspective. But we did get behind schedule. We engaged in a corrective action plan with the vendor. We're still working through that.
How far behind schedule
are we? The initial schedule would have had the bulk of the system being implemented early this year. We got a system in December. Based on the feedback we got from counties and our own staff, about 65% of the functionality is there, so we have to work on the remaining 35%.
Why did it fall behind?
There are a number of reasons, and I don't want to sound like making excuses. We started this project in 2020, and 2020 was a unique election cycle. We didn't
and 24
make a lot
well.
Of momentum in 2020. So beginning in 2021, we started working on sort of the development phase of the new system.
And I don't mean to cut you off, but I see the light's yellow. So just to wrap up, I'm wondering, for the contract with the vendor, between the vendor and the Department of State, would we be able to be provided a copy of that so we could see exactly what's to be expected if there are, in fact, benchmarks, and if there's any chance that we can have the system implemented by 2024?
Sure, we can provide all the contract documentations. I believe most of it's posted on the Department of General Services website, but we can give you additional documentation.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And Representative, I can just very quickly say, in reference to something that you mentioned, the timing of it is incredibly important. That the system has to be absolutely perfect before it goes live, so that when county election administrators are working with it, they're comfortable with it, and we don't have any mistakes occur, especially in an environment where any errors are perceived as being either nefarious or intentional or something like that. And also the timing around high turnout elections. It's usually best to avoid implementing a new system during that time.
Thank the gentlelady. Representative Kincaid.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you all for being here today. I don't have election questions for you. So I want to actually talk about the Interstate Nursing and Physicians Compacts. We just entered into the Interstate Nursing Compact last session. We've been in the Interstate Physicians Compact, but neither of them are actually operational in the state of Pennsylvania. And at a time that we are so critically short on healthcare providers, why are we running into administrative roadblocks in actually implementing these critical programs?
And Representative, we share that frustration. The way that the compact gets finally approved is a very awkward and very inefficient one. Right? It's us seeking approval from our federal partners, doing so through the Pennsylvania State Police. The federal partners review it. I know it's important to the governor. Last week, the governor reached out to Senators Casey and Fetterman about this to try to make sure that our federal partners are treating this with the time-sensitive, with the interest in getting it quickly done as much as we are. But it is a lengthy process going back and forth where our federal partners either approve or disapprove. And when they disapprove, they don't, or reject it. They don't reject it by saying, no, you should do this instead. It's just sort of rejected. Mm-hmm. So it is a lengthy process. I know the governor has reached out to federal partners about it, and we're committed to seeing this done and will not have any delays on our end in that back and forth.
So in news reports that have come out about why this is taking so long, it's been kind of alluded that it is there's an issue with the fingerprinting or the background check process that either the state doesn't have, that it doesn't match in some capacity. Is that your understanding of what's been holding it up?
Yes, and when it finally gets approved, we'll be returning to you for minor changes that will be required to make it work. I'd like to ask Deputy Secretary Johnson to speak to this as well.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Secretary. As the Secretary just referenced, the process of actually operationalizing our role in the compact requires, one, the legislative authorization, and then the actual administrative process of developing that functionality in the existing PAL system, with also an eye toward making sure that we capture that functionality in the new system. But then also, there's a logistical process of working with our partners at Pennsylvania State Police, because they are the conduit through which that information is returned from our federal partners. So there's some training that will be involved as well. But we are, to the ability that we can, we are working to capture what that functionality looks like, so we can be ready for when we do get that approval, so that we're not just sitting around waiting. So we are doing what we can in the meantime.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Related to professional licensure, obviously we have a medical marijuana program. One of the issues that we see in some professional licensure, particularly nurses and physicians, they can actually use opioids in treatment of pain or chronic conditions, autoimmune issues, but they cannot use medical marijuana, or they are endangering their professional licenses. And I'm wondering if you are doing anything to address that issue or to kind of fix the eligibility of people with professional licenses to not have their licenses endangered by use of medical marijuana that they're eligible to use.
So to the extent that I can answer that question, a lot of the answer is wrapped up in what the current act allows. I'm talking about if you're talking about physicians, you're talking about the Medical Practice Act, or for whichever licensed health practitioner you're referring to, the Practice Act will be the determinant of what their scope of practice is and what constitutes a proper scope of practice and what constitutes disciplinary action. Right now, we're responsible for implementing the law that is in place. It would take a legislative change for the type of use that you're talking about. And I'm presuming that there would also be some collaboration with the Department of Health and the Medical Marijuana Advisory Board, on which the acting commissioner does sit as a member. But again, there are a number of legislative and administrative steps that would have to take place before we can begin to talk about those changes in the scope of practice.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank the gentlelady, Representative Eric Nelson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Welcome, Mr. Secretary. I'd like to pick up a little bit of where previous questioner, Representative Mihalik, left off in relation to the SHORE system, and specifically kind of trying to better understand why the SHORE system, the new SHORE system, is still not operational. Election integrity, I think, is something that we seek on both sides of the aisle. And I was, Deputy Secretary Marks, you've testified multiple times before the State Government Committee, but you had mentioned in your answers today that the work started in 2020, and then more work occurred in 2021. But sir, this is, I totally understand performance-based contract. The contractor has a desire to get things done and move things forward. It's a $20 million contract. It's now spring of 2023, and we're still not done. Can you be a little bit more specific about where these missteps are occurring? What is the disconnect for election integrity and a new SHORE system?
Thank you for your question. I'm glad we actually followed up on this. I should have followed my gut and punted to Ms. Mattis. We actually did not request an increase, sure. I believe that was for PALS, the professional licensure. And as you noted, as the Secretary noted, it's performance-based or deliverable-based contracts, so we're not paying for things we haven't gotten. I think 2000...
Is the delay that the Department of State of Pennsylvania in 2 years hasn't received anything from the contractor? Or is it a shifting of expectations? I mean, it's a this is multiple years that the state is waiting for a reliable voter system, and we're right. And we're still not there yet.
Right. It was always intended to be a multiple-year project, so the fact that it's multiple years is not an issue, but we're certainly behind schedule, and that's why we engaged a corrective action plan with the vendor, and we looked internally as well. Not everything is on the vendor. You know, getting people to you know, focus on moving forward with an off-the-shelf system. The goal of this project was to use a system that has been utilized in other jurisdictions and not build, again, a homegrown system from scratch.
It does contribute to the conundrum, right? Because it is an off-the-shelf system.
Right.
I guess as we're moving, because really the bulk of my question was looking more towards, you know, Act 88, which was an election integrity law, bipartisan, that was passed to be able to help supply election dollars. You know, in August, counties were to apply. September of 2022, the dollars went out. There were four counties that did not apply for those election grants. Was there a reason, or did the department get an understanding why they chose not to engage?
So my understanding is some of the counties were reluctant to, in accepting those dollars, there are obligations that the county should follow that come with that. Those are the strings attached, right?
Yes, and those strings, really the bulk of my question, specifically the 90-day post-election audit, you know, where those counties were to supply information back again. It's my understanding a number of counties did not meet that deadline. Do you know how many counties actually submitted the 90-day post-election audit in a timely manner, sir?
I believe all but two, and there was one that was completed after that time limit. They completed it, but it was after the deadline, and one other county that that did not complete it. The other aspect of what comes along with the obligations with those dollars is my understanding that some counties were reluctant to commit to begin processing mail-in ballots at 7 a.m. on election morning and continuing uninterrupted until that process was concluded. In my personal experience, it doesn't take dollars to want to do that, and that you commit to doing that so that voters know the results earlier and the process is conducted as expeditiously as possible. But my understanding, and Deputy Secretary Marks can correct me if I'm wrong, some counties were reluctant to do that.
In your opinion, sir, and I know it's a subjective question, I'm just about out on my time, we ended the Zuckerbucks, which was highly controversial. Do you feel that Act 88 helped to increase that election integrity and those dollars were well spent within
the gentleman's time has expired? Mr. Secretary, if you could, 30 seconds.
Yes, categorically, yes. The counties are pretty broadly under-resourced when it comes to election administration. As important as it is, it's sometimes not the priority of the counties. Have a lot to worry about, right? And elections, like I said before, sort of there's a lot of attention on them, and then the attention goes away. So they're not always resourced the way they should be. I think those dollars are, from the feedback we've received, are well received and will assist with election administration at the county level.
Thank you. Thank you for the extra 30 seconds, Mr. Chair.
Absolutely. Thank the gentleman, Representative Malagari.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Acting Secretary. Thank you for being here, and thank you to your staff as well.
Thank you.
I have a question with regard to some of the funding that has been asked as an additional budget recommendation for the governor. This has to do with professional licensure. So there's a $10 million and change increase in professional and occupational affairs to continue current programming and to upgrade and replace the professional licensing system. My question is, what is that money going to do, and how is that money going to be utilized in order to reduce barriers to licensure and also to make the process a little bit more seamless? Full disclosure, my wife is a licensed clinical social worker. I hear about it all of the time, about some of the barriers that she and her colleagues and other coworkers deal with regard to just trying to get information from the department, but also trying to understand the requirements as well. What do you think that money will do to make it easier for our professionals?
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you, Representative. The PAL system replacement is, as you know, desperately needed. We completed the RFQ as part of it. We're completing the RFP part of it. We're looking to issue that probably around September of this year. The new PAL system, which is what those $10 million are going toward, will offer a number of features, not just making it more transparent, not just making it more user-friendly, but will also prevent some of the problems from occurring that we've seen. For example, an applicant will no longer be able to submit an incomplete application. So when we're measuring how long it takes to complete to process an application, there's how long does it take to process a complete application versus how long does it take to process an application that is incomplete. And that's not putting the blame on the applicant. Sometimes the applicant doesn't provide the information, but oftentimes that information has to come from a third party. That, you know, the applicant did their part and they're waiting on the third party to provide it. So the new system will require that the application be complete when it enters the sort of workflow. And I think that's an important change to it as well. Deputy Secretary, is there anything else you'd like to add in terms of benefits to the PALS replacement system?
No, Secretary, I think you've answered the bulk of the questioning. I would add, with respect to education of the regulated community, those improvements to the system allow staff to focus on some of those policy-based initiatives that you're talking about in terms of informing and educating the regulated communities. Right now, we are so inundated with the influx of applications and dealing with an inefficient system that we don't really have the opportunity to focus on those other aspects.
I look forward to the system being upgraded. I applaud the ask for that, and I think it's a good thing for our Commonwealth and also moving forward for our workforce. I thank you for your work in that, and that concludes my questions. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Representative.
Thank the gentleman, Representative Owlett.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for being here. You're getting hit from both sides of the aisle, and kind of everybody's dancing around this a little bit. I'm just going to get right to it, okay? So I've heard things like removing barriers, behind schedule, roadblocks, administrative roadblocks, things taking too long. Here you're asking for another $1.75 million for a new IT system for notaries. Help us understand, you know, things haven't been going well. I mean, the PAL system, the SURE system, constitutional amendment failures. I mean, it's been a rough road. What are you going to do, Mr. Secretary, to make sure that next year, 10 months from now, when we're back here talking about this, that we're not having these same conversations about things taking too long, behind schedule? What are you, we talked to the deputy of, or the secretary of DEP, and we talked about culture versus strategy. What's the strategy to change the culture at the Department of State?
Just very briefly, at the beginning of your question, it mentioned notary replacement. And again, notaries right now relies on the infrastructure of the PAL system. So when the PAL system is getting replaced, that's why it's necessary to create the system for notaries to use as PALS sort of goes away. For me, from my professional background, I spent years as a senior performance auditor for the federal government, for something called the Government Accountability Office, where I worked for Democrats and Republicans in the House, in the Senate, members and committees to audit the performance of federal programs, policies, and procedures to make sure that you eliminate waste, fraud, abuse, mismanagement, and equally to make sure that that government services are delivered efficiently and effectively. So I'll be leaning heavily on that performance management experience that I've had before I ever entered the election sort of space when it comes to these programs and these systems and keeping things on track. Sometimes there are things that occur that are beyond your control.
Right, absolutely.
But there are things that are within your control. And you know, that background is something that I'll certainly be leaning on in the days ahead at the Department of State.
I mean, I think that's exactly right. I mean, there are things that in life we need to control the things that we can control. And we all know that there are things outside of our control. But you can understand the skepticism that this committee might have when it comes to a new program, more money, when it wouldn't be a State Department hearing without talking about the failures of the SURE system, the PAL system, people being concerned. So I think that's my point, is I think you're hearing it from both sides of the aisle, which I think is important to recognize, that there are things that we can do better and we must do better, and I look forward to your leadership. And if this was in the private sector, it would be a failure and people would be let go. But we're in the public sector, and we need to do better, and appreciate any leadership you can have. So 10 months from now, we can have a different story and a different conversation around this table.
Thank you, Representative.
Thank you. I gave you time back, Mr. Chairman.
You did indeed. I'll remember that maybe next week or something, in 2 weeks. Thank the gentleman, Representative Mullins.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, thank you for being here. Briefly, I know cybersecurity is a growing concern across the board, across our globe, as it relates to things at the Department of State and within the Commonwealth. I know there was an interest expressed during the Senate Appropriations budget hearing on cybersecurity. Just wanted to know what is contained within the budget proposal. And what additional resources might the Department of State need to discuss with us when we're arriving at a final budget to enhance or augment the cybersecurity efforts? Because I know there's federal funding, of course, but from the state and local perspective, I think there should be no limit to the amount we do to combat this.
Well, I know the Department of State does and has in the past relied on our federal and state partners to always test the infrastructure of our system to avoid any vulnerabilities by malicious or bad faith actors to disrupt it. Votes, as you know, for example, are calculated at the county level, but they get reported up and through Department of State. In terms of our infrastructure, it's really on the front end when it comes to voter registration database, or SURE, and on the tail end when it comes to reporting election results. And even if the area where you're reporting election results wouldn't compromise having a single vote counted or not counted, it would create a lot of uncertainty about the results and all the rest. So I know that we've worked with federal and state partners, and routinely do, where they're always testing and probing our system to try to identify vulnerabilities. If I may, I'd like to ask Deputy Secretary Marks to add to my comments.
Thank you, Secretary, and thank you for the question, Representative. The department has, over the last couple of years, made a specific, or paid specific attention to security, cybersecurity, and physical security, particularly around elections. We have one division within our Bureau of Elections is committed to issues related to security and technology. Certainly the vacancies that we have currently don't help, but we're committed to finding competent individuals with the experience that we need to address those things. But the department works with multiple federal and state partners, including PEMA, the Governor's Office of Homeland Security, the FBI, and I'm forgetting a few, but we work with those partners to provide training to counties on an annual basis, and we're going to continue to double down on those efforts as well. We've also made significant investments in our own infrastructure, working with the Office of Administration and also our federal partners, primarily the Department of Homeland Security.
I appreciate that. You preempted my second or follow-up question about interagency cooperation and that, you know, making sure that those lines of communication and collaborative efforts are intact and strong. And I would, you know, as we move forward and to the budget process and also into a more concerning and scary future in the world of cybersecurity, I trust that you would get back to us with other things we could be doing to meet those threats. As someone whose state rep Instagram was recently cloned, I know this pales in comparison to some of the most terrifying scenarios, but whoever they were, they were communicating with constituents about cryptocurrency. So they were showing me up as, it was a constituent service I didn't know that I was providing, but it just shows it's everywhere in big and little forms, so.
And just as an aside, Representative, when I mentioned my former federal experience, it was in the Homeland Security and Homeland Defense area, specifically focused on critical infrastructure, physical infrastructure, and working with federal agencies to harden those targets and prevent them from being penetrated by bad faith actors.
Thank you.
So, Kyle, you're telling me that wasn't you that was giving me that advice?
I'm sorry to let you down. This is what you got. Check mark verified. So.
Thank the gentleman. Representative Struzzi.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and good morning.
Good morning.
Mr. Secretary. I'd like to continue the line of discussion along the professional licensure system, PALS. One of the biggest constituent requests we get is help navigating the process, help expediting the process. I have IUP in my district as well as Indiana Regional Medical Center, so there's a lot of medical professionals coming out of school looking for these licenses to be issued in a timely manner, and we're hearing of extreme delays, months and months, and quite frankly, that's unacceptable. It has been unacceptable, and not anecdotally, we are losing people to other states that can actually mm-hmm. issue these licenses in a timely manner. Now, I know that you've requested $10 million to update, replace the system, but you just said in your previous discussion that you're not even going to issue the RFP until September. So when will the project actually start?
The expectation is that the new PALS replacement system would be implemented in late 2024.
So not until late 2024. So we're going to have to go back and continue to tell our constituents that are seeing these extreme delays in the issuance of their license. It's going to be almost 2 years until they can see an improvement.
Well, there's two critical aspects for as we've determined that caused the delays. Mm-hmm. Or the length of time it takes in which to process applications. One is certainly PALS mm-hmm. And uniform acceptance that it needs to be replaced and is not performing the way that it should. Every bit as important are the number of vacancies that we're currently facing in our department. We have in BPOA alone, the Board of Nursing, for example, mm-hmm. about 50% of those positions are vacant. And that's not just about hiring. The clerk ones are very important and they're critically needed and everything else like that. But in terms of some of these positions, they're pretty specialized. Mm-hmm. So it's not just a matter of hiring a clerk to process a filing or an application. They have to review it to make sure that we're fulfilling our responsibilities to protect the health and safety of the public. Nursing is that shortage, that those vacancies are, like I said, acute at 50%. Throughout BPOA, it's more like 30%, but it is a significant number. So we've been meeting with the Office of Administration and our HR representatives there to figure out how we can best fill those vacancies and what proactive steps we can take to fill those vacancies. So if we have, for example, 8 vacancies, do we advertise for 8 vacancies, knowing that by the time we fill them, 3 other people will leave? Or should we, in fact, advertise for 11 vacancies when we have 8, knowing that by the time that process is completed, and that process can take as long as 3 months, and most people, most normal people, cannot wait 3 months for that process to be completed, and they've taken a job elsewhere, because the salary is not necessarily the most competitive, and the conditions are difficult. Like you mentioned, like they're the ones receiving those calls too, right? They're the ones that have to process those applications sitting next to a desk that's vacant and answer the phone from constituents calling and asking what's taking so long to provide them updates on that. So there is, in performance management, a sort of the performance death spiral that occurs because the clerk has to process applications. The clerk also has to answer the phone. And they can't process the applications and answer the phone at the same time, especially with so many vacancies.
Right. But you can work your way out of that. Is your entire workforce back to work, or are they, you have people still working from home?
It really varies throughout the department. Obviously, many of our employees are 5 days a week in person. There are others that about 75% of our employees are sort of eligible for some degree of telework or other. That might be one day every 2 weeks or one day a week. It is by far a minimum of 50% in person, right, depending on what the role is. But if you were a clerk in BCCO, throughout COVID, throughout everything else, you were in person every day because they're processing paper applications that they can't take home, that they don't shuffle back and forth, and they have to be there in front of their terminal processing those. So some positions offer more flexibility when it comes to telework. Other positions, it's just not an option.
Sure, sure. I understand the workforce challenges. I think we do need to have people in every seat to process these. I'm almost out of time, but this is a very serious issue. And you know, to tell people 2 years from now we're going to fix this problem, we get to fix it now, because we do have a workforce issue in healthcare in many of these fields that require licensure. So I would encourage you to do everything above and beyond PALS to make sure these people are getting their licenses issued in an appropriate and timely manner. So thank you.
And I know it is about a person earning a livelihood, and it is also about lives on the line when it comes to medical professions.
Thank the gentleman. Representative Webster.
Thanks, Chairman, and to Secretary Schmidt and team. We're really glad you're here, so thanks for being here today. I may regret this, but I'm going to take us back a little bit towards mail-in voting with a couple of questions. This legislature had asked the Joint State Government Commission to look at changes or reform to the mail-in balloting, and they came back in January, just passed, with 5 recommendations. I'm not sure that you should be expected to know what those were at this time, but they're really simple, straightforward, the kinds of things that, in my estimation, would say Pennsylvania and good government all at the same time, which we may not hear. So this is sort of just a recommendation that looking at that report, and there are 5 recommendations, real simple things. The other quick twist, and maybe a question, is personal to me around mail-in voting and overseas veterans. So the short of that is, when we're talking about back and forth in these policy discussions around voter ID, I can tell you that the federal voting assistance program told New Jersey that their approach was likely unconstitutional at the federal level, particularly because of overseas veterans who would not be able to meet an ID standard from the Horn of South Africa. So I guess what I, to get to a question, because I think some of this is just resonating in my head and I want to say out loud, but from a question, I'd like to see what, commitment and effort that our Department of State will apply to the simple, straightforward protection of voting rights for all Pennsylvanians, but because I'm a veteran, for all of our serving military members.
Well, first of all, Representative, thank you for your service. I am familiar with the report that you mentioned and the recommendations. And when it comes to mail-in ballot voting and other ways to improve, I think, elections in Pennsylvania, and when you travel around and when you talk to election administrators in big counties and small, red and blue, no matter where you are, I think there's a lot of common denominators that you encounter, a lot of common agreement about different things that that could be improved, even in an environment that is as contentious as the one that we've been in, certainly in the last few years. One I've obviously heard a lot about is mail-in ballot pre-canvassing. And the benefits, which is part of that, right, the recommendations in that report, that would result in one, us knowing the election results sooner, because voters are accustomed to knowing the results. An election, unless an election is extremely close, used to knowing the results on election night. And also from my perspective, a benefit to the election integrity side of it as well, where instead of in a county like Philadelphia, you have 100 clerks working in 8-hour shifts, 24 hours a day. If that process is lengthened, even by a few days, it allows it to be conducted on a smaller scale with observers present from the parties, from the campaigns, rather than 24 hours a day, full tilt. So I think there's an election integrity benefit to it, and I think there's a benefit to knowing the results sooner, like voters are accustomed to.
Yeah. And I'm hoping there's significant similar feelings and support for those kinds of straightforward, benefits for Pennsylvania voters. So
thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman.
Thank the gentleman, Representative Lawrence.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'd like to thank all of you for being here today. Appreciate your service.
Thank you.
Mr. Secretary, the governor's pledged that anyone who doesn't get their license in 90 days will get their money back. We're talking about professional licensure. We've talked about it a lot today, nurses, doctors. The licensing boards are self-funded. So going forward, if a constituent of mine doesn't get their nursing license in 90 days, where will the money come from for the rebate? The nursing board's segregated account or the general fund?
The governor's executive order, which you're referring to, and in every conversation that I've had with him, has made perfectly clear how important this issue is. And there are different steps to get to where we'll ultimately be. The first step, which we've concluded, is identifying the total universe of licenses and permits and everything else that we issue with the Department of State, and that number is north of 900. It's north of 900 if you include renewals and if you include reactivations and other permutations of each license. The second stage is really determining, and this is getting to your question, is determining how long each of those should take to process. What is the reasonable amount of time an applicant should have to wait for the department to conduct the review of the application to, again, protect the health and safety of the public? And then the third component of that after you've made that determination, is what's the threshold for them to receive their fee back? And it's really an element of accountability when it comes to that. Ideally, the whole point of this entire exercise is to not return a fee to anybody, to never reach a point where if an application isn't processed within an amount of time, that fee would be returned at all, because once those benchmarks are in place for how long it should take, there is certainly an expectation to not be in a position where we're returning any fees. I'm sure you wouldn't look kindly on that. I know the governor would not look kindly on that, and that's the obligation that'll be on us.
Certainly, and I can't tell you how much I appreciate the governor's focus on this, but I come back to the question, where would the money come from for the rebate? The nursing board's segregated account or the general fund?
It would come from the board's account, should it ever occur.
Following up on Representative Kincaid's question, she mentioned the licensing compacts, and I'm very concerned about that. And to be candid, I was a little concerned about some of the answers I heard previously. The first licensing compact was passed 7 years ago. 7 years. And it still hasn't been implemented. In my view, it's unacceptable. Now, we've since passed nurses, physical therapists. My question is this. My understanding is that once these compacts are signed into law, the Department of State must submit to the federal government for approval or denial. Can you state which of these compacts have actually received, clearly we haven't received an approval, have we actually received a denial from the federal government, and on what basis, what step exactly needs to be taken to remedy the situation?
Deputy Secretary, if you wouldn't mind adding to this.
So, thank you, Secretary. So, with respect to your question, Representative, the The nurse licensure compact was initially denied. The legislation that was enacted was initially denied with respect to meeting the federal partner's approval for authorization to receive criminal background checks. The interstate medical licensure compact also was denied by the federal partner.
On what basis?
On the basis that they don't meet the federal requirements for the department or the state to receive.
So it's been 7 years, and we have not gotten an answer on this. I would like very much for you, or you, Mr. Secretary, to submit in writing to the chairman of this committee and to the chairman of the licensure committee the exact reason. Dozens of other states have not gotten denied. This is happening in dozens of other states. What's the holdup? If it's a legislative fix, then let's get on it. If it's an executive fix, then I'm sure the governor will get on it. If it's a federal fix, then let's get our congressional delegation engaged. But I would like something in writing. 7 years is too long to wait on this. It is affecting patient care and licensure of medical professionals across the Commonwealth.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, gentlemen. Representative Salisbury.
Thank you very much for being here with us today. I had the opportunity at the end of February to meet with some personnel from DOS Corporations to talk about the lengthy delays that have been mentioned with relation to your department, but in particular with the formation of new businesses and nonprofit organizations. So at one time, I, as an attorney, was forced to explain to my clients why it takes in excess of 2.5 months in this state to start a business or a charitable organization, trying to do good during COVID and a potential recession. I was told by your department that you would get that number down below 45 days, and I do see that that has happened, so I thank you. But my question is, does this budget contain sufficient funding to bring in staff? Because I was told that that is part of the problem, that there's insufficient staffing. Does this contain sufficient funding for you to bring in, recruit, maintain, and attract talent to get these processing times back to where they once were, which was a day?
Representative, this budget does accommodate paying for the salaries and benefits of the vacancies that we currently have in that bureau, BCCO. When I came in January, it took roughly 8 weeks for those filings to be completed. That number is now down to 4 weeks. That is a result of the hard work of the staff. It is a result of mandatory overtime that we implemented in January. That is not a long-term solution to fixing this, but the issues that we've seen, BCCO does have a new IT system that was replaced at the very end of last year, resulting in no applications being able to be processed for about 10 days. And those applications that were coming in paper. And paper applications take roughly 4 times as long as it takes an electronic application to get processed. So BCCO is sort of digging out from under that that sort of backlog that occurred with the transition when it happened. And you know, mandatory overtime is not a long-term solution to fixing things. You can only do that for so long, but filling those vacancies is an important part of it, so that once we do get our head above water, we can keep it there when it comes to processing those applications in as close to real time as possible.
On an adjacent issue, I don't believe it falls under professional licensing directly, but under professional fundraising councils and professional solicitors, they're required to be registered with the state in order to raise money on behalf of nonprofit organizations. Are those also plan to be expedited in order to be able to fundraise for nonprofits in the Commonwealth?
Yes, please.
So, as we sit here today, there are no plans to expedite those particular registrations, but we would welcome any comments or any opportunities to collaborate with this body.
The current fine for working without being registered is $1,000 plus $100 a day if you raise money on behalf of an organization on a paid basis without having approval from the state of Pennsylvania. So that prevents nonprofit organizations from raising money all across the state for any number of charitable causes, from diseases to helping people with fallout from COVID, feeding programs for children, any number of things. So to my mind, it's very important to expedite those processing times, because if professional fundraisers are not able to enter into these government-mandated contracts with nonprofits, they are unable to get money into the pockets of nonprofits during a time when we may be facing a recession and when nonprofit charitable donations are significantly down during COVID and as we hopefully enter a post-COVID pandemic period of time. So I would just like to emphasize that as you move forward, if you could direct some resources and attention into expediting those processing times so that nonprofits are able to get money into their pockets through grant funding and charitable solicitation actions, that would be greatly appreciated.
Thank you, Representative.
Thank you very much.
Thank the gentlelady, Representative Mustello.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Secretary. What sort of investments do you plan to make within Pennsylvania, within each of the 67 counties, to have maybe a comprehensive election director education program? I mean, being a former election director yourself, I'm sure you know the needs, well aware of the situations going on. As you know, Pennsylvania is one of the few states that don't have one of these programs. So what investments are you going to make? I mean, I see, you know, some of the expenditures here and in the budget that you've provided. What do you plan to do about that?
And Deputy Secretary Marks and I will be meeting with, there's a conference of election administrators from across the state just, I think, early next week. And we'll be meeting with them there. We've had several conversations with election administrators and with CCAP about sort of what resources we can provide when it comes to new people being responsible for running elections. As you know, in many counties, when an election administrator leaves, they just transfer a clerk who was responsible for doing something else to now running elections. And when I came into elections in 2012, I was elected in 2011, responsible for running elections in the city. We had a significant number of people who had been with the department for a long time leave. The checklists of, there were no written checklists of things that we needed to do. They were all in the institutional memory of the people who had been in that role before. And consequently, in 2012, we made mistakes. We didn't know that we should do this or that on a certain day to make sure that that process gets completed. It's really not about telling counties what to do. It's about making sure that they're aware of the things that should be done in advance of Election Day to prepare for that. I think especially absent any third-party funding of elections in when it comes to election administration, I think Department of State can and will play an important role in providing resources to the counties and to election administrators to assist them with the training they need.
So will those resources that you're talking about, will they include a program, a uniform program for all 67 counties?
Well, we're meeting
each county. Yeah. I understand we have a very diverse state here.
To some extent, I want to make sure that it's needs-driven, right? We will be meeting with the election administrators to hear from them what they think they need and what they would have liked to have had in the past when they came into those positions.
And along those lines, you know, with the county election directors, maybe a way to clean up some of the voter rolls that that we have. Will you allow or at least entertain maybe the idea of allowing election directors or counties to have access to certain state agencies where maybe they can, you know, look at maybe some of the people who have passed away from the different agencies, Fish and Game, Health, the DMV, L&I even. So are those maybe possibilities that maybe you're looking at?
And in Pennsylvania, the answer is yes, but there are severe limits on that. For example, we can only cancel registrations in Pennsylvania for a deceased voter if notified by the Department of Health, or there are a few other really minor exceptions.
But do counties have access to that, or
they
is
do.
It only the state?
The state provides a notification to every county of, here's the list of people who moved to a different county. Here's a list from the Department of Health.
How often do you send that? I'm just curious. How often do you send those out to the counties?
So there are ongoing changes of address that are coming primarily from the DMV, from PennDOT.
Mm-hmm.
Annually, counties do list maintenance activities, which includes a national change of address program, the five-year notice program. In addition to that, we're getting additional cross-state and in-state mover data through our membership in the ERIC program that gives counties access to moves that don't come in the national change of address program, because that's voluntary, not required to participate in that. So that is ongoing. But in the summer is when they do kind of those big programs, the national change of address, the five-year, and the additional cross-state and in-state movers. We would like to use we can get additional deceased voter information through our membership in ERIC if the statute were broadened to allow us.
The statute from who? From the state or statute?
From our state statute. It's very prescriptive right now, and it prevents the department and counties from using deceased voter information from ERIC that they're getting through an agreement with Social Security Administration. Mm-hmm.
And one reason I just want to add to that for why voters remain on the roll so long, unless we're notified by the Department of Health or unless we have information that they moved to a different state and registered in a different state or registered elsewhere in the state, is that from tooth to tail, between federal law and state law, a voter has to be inactive for roughly 7 years before their record is canceled. That's missing at least 14 elections in a row, not including special elections or anything else like that, before that registration is canceled.
Well, that's good. Well, I'm looking forward to seeing some of the updates you're making, some of the improvements you're going to make with all the 67 directors. So that's good to hear. Thank you.
Thank you, Gentlelady. Representative Young.
Thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you.
I have two questions. One is around drop box expansion and same-day voter options. In your experience in working in election cycles, have you ever been told by any counties that the drop box aren't useful, underutilized, or simply not needed? And or do you hear that counties are asking for more access to those type of options?
Well, I know in our county, one reason why drop boxes were very useful was the deadline to apply for a mail-in ballot right now is 7 days before that ballot is due back. So if you're a voter and you follow the law, you follow the rules, right, and you apply on or before the deadline, if you apply around the deadline, even if that Board of Elections is able to process that application in 24 hours and get that ballot mailed out to you, it is not realistic to think that that ballot will, through the mail, make it to you, for the voter to complete their ballot and mail it back in that narrow amount of time. It results in ballot voters who follow the rules, they applied on the deadline, not having their ballot returned to the Board of Elections through no fault of the Board of Elections and no fault of the voter. Drop boxes provide a little bit of a relief valve for that compressed time frame so that the voter can return that mail-in ballot directly to the Board of Elections.
Thank you. And can you think of any reasons why PA should not implement same day or automatic voter registration?
Well, our system, and I know, and the department has certainly been in the past and is in favor of anything that makes it easier for an eligible voter to register to vote and a registered voter to cast their vote and have their vote counted. There are a lot of details that go into that, right? We're working with a very antiquated system, and whenever those changes are made, it's important that all the different pieces that are involved work together. So the way Pennsylvania has been handling elections for a very long time is it's like an addition on an addition on an addition, but the structure itself is a sort of antiquated one. But just generally, as a guiding principle, anything that makes it easier for an eligible voter to register to vote and to cast their vote and have it counted that doesn't in any way compromise the integrity of the process is something that is worth supporting.
Thank you.
Thank you, Representative.
Thank you, Gentlelady. Representative Flood.
Thank you, Chairman. Thank you to the panel for being here today.
Thank you.
Following up on voter registration and the previous governor's voter initiative. The governor's proposed budget includes $70,000 for an initiative to increase resources for voter registration efforts as a result of Governor Wolf's executive order number 2022-03 last September. The process to register to vote is super simple, where I can simply go online and register. I can mail in a registration form from my county. I can register in person. I can have when I have my picture taken at the DMV, I can have it done there. So with the simplicity of this process, do you really feel that this additional $70,000 in spending is necessary?
I'd like to ask Deputy Secretary Marks to speak about that aspect of the budget.
Thank you, Secretary, and thank you for the question, Representative. The $70,000 is primarily for forms. One of the department's statutory obligations is to not only develop and print a voter registration mail application, but also to provide it to counties and even to individuals and organizations. That $70,000 is for printing of paper voter registration forms that would be handed out at those agencies. It is relatively easy to register to vote for most people. I don't think it is for all people. There's still about 2 million people roughly in Pennsylvania who are eligible to register and they're not registered. So that executive order that you mentioned expanded the number of agencies through which voter registration opportunities would be provided. So the $70,000 is really just for paper forms that those agencies then can hand out to eligible registrants.
When the agencies or even the boards of elections need voter registration applications, it's the Department of State that provides those voter registration applications to the county to provide to the voters. So we're providing one uniform application to register to vote, one uniform application to apply for mail-in ballot.
So strictly for printing? The $70,000 is strictly for printing?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank the gentlelady, Representative Siegel.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you, Secretary Schmidt, for being here today.
Thank you.
I just wanted to start first by saying that I think you are a true embodiment of someone who has put the country and the Commonwealth ahead of party and political expediency, and that you have assembled a staff that I think is a true reflection of that, and that should be admired and acknowledged in today's world. Further than that, I want to say that I think I view this year's budget conceptually and contextually as the building blocks for next year's election. And I want to speak today a little bit to your experience as a county election administrator and how we can ultimately invest in the building blocks of democracy, which here in Pennsylvania I really think is the county. They are the unsung heroes of our election system and those are and responsible for making sure that it's carried out in a timely, fair, and secure process. So my first question is, I've heard a lot, as a former county employee, I worked for Lehigh County for 5 years, 10th largest county in the state, and the election integrity grant program was very helpful, but what I've heard consistently is that it's still not enough, that there are significant financial limitations, that the program itself comes with a number of barriers in terms of application and some sort of stringent limitations. So my first question to you is really, what can we do to expand and is there an intention to ultimately put more money towards making sure that counties have the requisite resources they need to hire the poll workers and the staff? Because ultimately, I think when it comes to election integrity, that's the first thing to do is make sure that elections are being resolved quickly and that votes are being counted very expeditiously.
Well, first of all, thank you for your kind words. And, despite our role in elections, it is really at the county level where they are administered. And on election day, it's not even on the county level, it's at the precinct level, right? Your neighbors and friends who work a 14-hour day to make sure that you can cast your vote and have your vote counted. Ultimately, the resources put into that program would be up to the General Assembly and the governor and run through DCED. But we do know, even though it's really the county election administrators interacting with DCD, we work with the county administrators a lot as well, and have certainly heard how helpful those resources are to pay for a lot of the things that are involved in every election, whether it's a presidential election or an election for county office. It's the same number of precincts. It's the same number of election board workers. It's the same number of amount of preparation that goes into every election that is extremely expensive. And these resources are helping to go pay for those.
Thank you for that. And I want to just drill down a little bit more into the nuance of some of the things I think that are a structural barrier. And we sit on the eve of the 2024 presidential election, which is likely to probably be, if not equally as high as turnout was in 2020, probably more. And there are some real structural issues that we're going to have. And one of them I know is a sensitive issue is really the difficulty in recruiting poll workers. The wages for a poll worker really are not sufficient. It's tough to ask somebody to give up, 12, 14 hours of their day for, frankly, a wage that I think is substandard given the scale of what we're asking them to do and the importance of it. So is there any conversation or discussion about how we can recruit new poll workers, particularly younger folks, communities of color, bilingual? That's a huge barrier. Our poll workers are very old and they're aging out.
And I think there are two major challenges to overcome there. The one challenge, as you mentioned, is with all of the changes to elections, with new voting systems, new in-person voting systems, like most counties have, with mail-in ballot voting, and election board workers in person, at the precinct still need to deal with aspects of mail-in ballot voting. If a voter brings in their mail-in ballot, and can they vote on the machine, or the provisional ballot, or any of that? Election administration, including at the precinct level on election day, has become a lot more complex, and you had, fortunately, a terrific universe of people who have been doing it for a long time, and some of them just don't want the hassle of making this change to these, with all these changes. The other aspect of it that you mentioned is compensation for election day. In Philadelphia, for example, the pay was about $100 for a 14-hour day. Always a challenge, whether it's a low turnout election, it's a challenge, or a high turnout election, it's a challenge. And just very recently, that amount was increased, fortunately. But that's really determined by the counties. The counties determine how much to pay those election board workers. But compensation is an important part. Recruitment is an important part, and knowing what and valuing the role that they play and making sure that voters cast their vote is an important part of this as well, and that they not have to deal with all sorts of grief and all that when they're volunteering essentially for a day.
Thank you, Secretary, and I see that I have 30 seconds, so I just want to ask one final question, and I just, again, tapping into your experience as a former election commissioner and serving in our largest county, would you, in your professional opinion, define the necessity of pre-canvassing, not just as a policy decision, but one that is an administrative necessity because it simply just allows, as you indicated earlier, our workers to be able to do this in a much longer period of time as opposed to forcing everyone to have a stressful, 24-hour, election binge where they've got to count ballots as fast as they can.
And election workers, and I've worked with them for 10 years, are going to work as hard as they can to get it done. So it's not about them complaining. It's not even about making their lives easier, although we should if we can. It's also the benefit of knowing the results sooner. It's also the benefit of that process taking place on a smaller scale over a greater number of days rather than around the clock for a sort of compressed time frame.
Well, thank you, Secretary, and thank you to you and your staff.
Thank you, Representative.
Thank the gentleman, Representative Cabell.
Mr. Chairman, and thank you all for being here today.
Thank you.
I represent a large portion of Luzerne County, so I'm sure you can imagine where I will be headed with this line of questioning. With Luzerne County being in the news over the last couple of months since our last election and previous ones as well, unfortunately, and with the congressional hearing yesterday regarding some of the issues in Luzerne County, obviously this is a topic that we should probably discuss in this forum. Luzerne County is one of eight counties that is under a home rule form of government. Most of those counties actually have a council form rather than commissioner. So they're obviously in a unique situation. Mm-hmm. And I've heard a lot today about loss of institutional knowledge from state down and in counties. I was just told that up to 80% of some of these counties have 80% of counties have lost their people from the last couple of years. So that's absolutely happening in Luzerne County, and the failures in a county such as Luzerne County leads to more loss and turnover and stuff like that, which exasperates the problem long term. I've also heard a lot about sending training materials and money being spent on this problem, and that's great, but I don't think money is going to solve this issue. I think, the idea of potentially sending people on site to actually train these folks and building that out from top down might make sense, especially for a county like Luzerne County. So My question to you is, are you planning on sending anybody to Luzerne County to help us out? Because we are in a unique, difficult situation. We're on the cusp of a primary election, and then obviously have a presidential election next year. So the question is, are you planning on sending anybody to Luzerne County to help us kind of figure our stuff out? And then if you were to do so, might it make sense to use us as a case study to build this out, build out some policy and procedure top down so we could hand that over to the other 66 counties in the state?
And you're right, Representative, Luzerne County is the perfect example of what happens when you not only lose a lot of experienced election administrators, but you then have high turnover, as there were several news stories that sort of looked into that, how frequently the people in those positions had changed over time and put into this very sensitive, time-sensitive and delicate environment. I want to make sure that we, like I mentioned before, and in response to one of the other representatives' questions, generate resources for new election administrators to rely on when they're conducting elections. Again, it's not about telling them what to do; it's about providing resources.
Might it be time to tell them what to? I'm sorry to interrupt you, but might it be time now, especially in a county like Luzerne, to tell them what to do, to really get more involved? And resources are great, but like resources, we need people on the ground in a county like Luzerne County helping us.
Well, we can't direct county election administration. What we can do is be a resource to them and have conversations about how to prevent situations like we've seen in Luzerne County from occurring. Obviously, it's a big commonwealth with 67 counties. Department of State won't have boots on the ground in counties all over, but in reaching out to these counties and figuring out what we can do to assist them during these times where there is a lot of turnover, I think would be an important part of this. I'd like to ask Deputy Secretary Marks to add to this as well.
Yes, thank you, and thank you for your question. As Secretary noted, they would have to want us there, number one, and this goes into the earlier question about training. One of the things we've done in restructuring our bureaus is to provide for a division within the Bureau of Elections that would be entirely about training. That would be its primary mission, to train county election officials. And we have to fill that complement. Right now we have one or two people working in that division, but we want to have a division that is committed to training officials. Right now we have to borrow people from other areas of the department to serve as county liaisons. These are people who reach out to counties frequently, make sure they have what they need. But we are certainly committed to handling that training component, and it's important that we have people who are committed to that full-time, and it's not just something they're doing part-time.
That's exactly what I'm asking, and I encourage you, and I hope that Luzerne County is on your radar and your team is discussing it.
Yes.
I encourage you to utilize us as a pilot. I could help coordinate that, because I know that the folks in my district, we hear it all the time, every single day. They're calling our office concerned about the election integrity, the processes. Chairman Grobe mentioned the state of Florida. You know, say what you want about the state of Florida in a lot of ways, but their election process seems to be top-notch, and I would love to see us model ourselves and try to get to a point where we know the results in hours, not days or weeks. So thank you. I appreciate your attention to this matter, and any way we could help, I would love to.
Thank you, Representative.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, gentlemen. We'll move now to our committee chairs. Chairman Roy, you're up next.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And thank you, folks, for your testimony. Up until probably, I've lost track, probably 3 or 4 years ago, it used to be on election night, when you looked at the Department of State website to look at election results, you know, the tentative ones, not the official mm-hmm. ones, which are done later, as we all know, you could see on there a race, and it might say, you know, 4,315 out of 9,160 precincts have reported, so you could see what percent of the vote had been counted. Probably 2 or 3 years ago, that got taken off of your website. So when you're looking there, you can't tell, have 99% of the precincts reported, have only half the precincts reported? That kind of disappeared from the website. Now last year, we passed House Bill 1300, which would have mandated that you guys have a website that shows, you know, how many people voted, what percent has been counted, just so the public could kind of monitor that. That was that same legislation that had ID to vote, It would have allowed people with disabilities to take service animals into polling sites. It would have, you know, done a lot of good things, but that got vetoed by the prior governor. But so I guess my question is, why is that no longer on the website? And is there any state law that would prevent you from having better information for the voters on the website?
Well, I can say that the part of the SURE system replacement is to replace the election night reporting component of all of that. I know that when we did the replacement in Philadelphia, the goal was to make as much information available to the public as possible when the results are coming in. There are certainly challenges when it comes, like you mentioned, precincts reporting. If you receive a voting machine results from one voting machine but not another machine, has that precinct not reported, or has that precinct sort of reported? So there are some challenges with the precinct reporting how many precincts have or haven't provided results yet. I can't really speak to the background for why those changes occurred in the past. If I may, I'd like to ask Deputy Secretary Marks add.
Seemingly, that situation didn't just start happening in the last two or three years, where some precinct might have the totals from one machine but not another machine. And you know, for years and years and years, you could follow what percent of the precincts have reported, and that just vanished off of your website.
I'm aware of the background, so I can answer your question. Okay. Thank you, Chairman. So the department removed that particular piece, or actually were hiding it, because we were getting a lot of questions and a lot of confusion from the media and from voters about the status of counting overall. So with the addition of mail balloting, it's not just in-person election day voting. So that number represents how many precincts are reporting in terms of in-person election day voting, and it was causing confusion. But we can certainly reverse that decision if it's helpful, and we can figure out how to message it so that people understand that when we talk about the number of precincts reporting on election night, that's in-person voting. It doesn't include all mail-in voting. There are other mechanisms, supplemental information that we provide regarding the status of mail-in voting, but we can certainly add that back in.
Okay, that would be good. Then, because I believe in transparency. When people, right before they go to bed, they look at that site, one candidate's winning, they wake up in the morning, somebody else won, and just wonder, oh, they must not have had very many counted. But my next question is about the campaign finance reporting website. In years past, if a candidate would file a one-page campaign finance statement, that was not on your website, so it would look like a candidate or a committee did not file. If the full-fledged campaign finance report was filed, that would be on your website. But then I was just looking last year, my personal reporting was done by campaign finance statements because it was under the $250 threshold, but on your website, you show that I filed the 10-page, 15-page campaign finance report, but I didn't do that. So I was just wondering why sometimes you don't post the statements on the website and it looks like a candidate or a committee didn't file. Other times you make it look like they filed the full-fledged report when the candidate actually filed a statement.
I would have to get, if you don't mind, I'd have to get some details. I work through our legislative staff regarding that specific issue. As I understand it, we're posting all statements now. It was something that we couldn't do previously, but I'm not aware of any changes other than adding that.
Right, you're
so
showing
that it's publicly available.
Yeah, you're showing a 10-page report was filed when a candidate actually only filed a one-page statement. So it just seems like you should be posting what the candidate actually filed.
Yes, and that's my understanding is how the system's supposed to work. So if there's an anomaly with that, I can get some additional information if you don't mind, and we can look into it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank the gentleman.
Thank you.
Chairman Conklin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I want to thank the panelists, and I've enjoyed a lot of really good questions asked today.
And I also want to thank you all, because no one realizes how rough it was in the last few years for you all to do your job. As I tell folks, I had the extreme privilege of overseeing the election process for 7 years. And to see those good election workers quitting because of the badgering they're getting on the streets, because those officials who do the elections are no longer wanting to be there, it's becoming more and more difficult. So I want to thank you all. And just one more commentary, I often jokingly say I think it should be mandatory for every elected legislator to take a course for 2 weeks in the elections office to understand exactly how they're run and why things are done. So with that, thank you. And hopefully under the committee, being a county commissioner, we've talked with them. There's some small lifts that we're going to be running. Hopefully we can get them through the House and through the Senate, such as things as easy as, you know, early canvassing, just to let those folks do it. Some counties, as you know, my county and other counties open those early ballots up first thing in the morning. Other counties waited for days before they opened up those early ballots. So hopefully we'll be able to make your job easier and we'll be able to make it more defined. So those counties have the tools. But my question is simply this. A lot of those advocates, those individuals that take care of those special needs adults, ask me to ask you one question. When you look at the precincts where they vote, when you look at the equipment, those individuals who are blind, hard of hearing, cognitive issues, they're asking, are there any plans long range for helping out the counties to make those precincts more accessible and other things more accessible for those individuals with disabilities?
I know in the past, a lot of the focus has been on really wheelchair accessibility, speaking in terms of like polling places, not the voting system, but the polling places. A lot of the focus had been in the past on making sure that polling places are wheelchair accessible, that the door is, you know, a certain number of inches wide, that a ramp is, you know, only so steep. And in some counties like Philadelphia with an older infrastructure, that's a real challenge because there are not a lot of buildings that can be used that are fully handicapped or are wheelchair accessible. I know the voting systems, when the voting systems go through the state certification process, and I assume the federal certification process as well, there are components that are required for different voters with different needs so that they can make sure they and are able to cast their vote in person on that system. I know whether it's a sip and puff system or an audible system that allows the voter to hear the ballot read out to them, that there are different ways that those systems and requirements have tried to accommodate those needs.
Thank you. And just to tell you how long I've been around, I actually implemented, after the Gore-Bush election, the first voting machines and the Shore system within the county. So you all are doing a great job. It's changing constantly, and it's up to us to give you those tools so you can move ahead with those changes. And thank you all for what you do.
Thank you, Chairman.
We thank the Chairman. Chairman Burns.
So thank you for coming today to give us some feedback. As chair of the Professional Licensure Committee, I'm left with no choice but to ask the most difficult question of all. You've heard from both sides of the aisle that there's issues with getting the licenses to the people. And I'm here to ask what we can do as a legislature. What is it we can do to help you improve that process?
I think, especially in terms of the budget side of it, the resources to, you know, replace the PAL system is a significant part of that. The other component of that is the resources to fill the vacancies that we have with the already authorized complement that we have. So it's more than just dollars, right? But those dollars are important in solving those two major obstacles in processing applications in a timely way. The IT system that we're using, and at the end of the day, a clerk still has to process that application, still has to review it to determine whether it's sufficient or not. And in the budget context, I think those are the two most important things to improve that system.
Well, my office is open to all of you as this evolves. Please keep in touch with us so that we can make sure that there's any other ways that we can assist to improve this process for the people of Pennsylvania.
We will. Thank you, Chairman.
We thank the gentleman, Chairman Grove.
Thank you, Chairman.
5 minutes.
What?
Joking. Oh, go ahead. I'm sorry, Seth. Go ahead. I had to, bro.
Dog it. Thank you, Chairman. Starting with the Shore system, when was the last payment to the vendor, and how much was that?
I don't know the exact amount, but the last payment was last June, I believe. It's the last time we made a payment.
So that, as you stated, that process is based on what they have provided us. So have they not provided us anything in the past year, or have they provided updates?
They provided access to the system with the development that has already been done, and that occurred in December. That I understand they have a list of deliverables they want to submit to us for our approval, but they have not yet submitted them. But I want to be clear on Shore modernization. We are not paying for things that we haven't received. This is deliverables-based contract. So until we get it, and until we confirm that it meets all the requirements that were outlined in the contract, we're not going to pay for it.
Okay. So I'm trying to read between the lines of what you have stated here. It sounds like you feel like the system will be live and ready to go in 2024. You have it out for beta testing to 23 counties, but you're very worried about the fact that it'll be live and ready to go during a presidential election.
I won't say that I'm worried, but this is a partnership with the counties, and we committed, and I know I've testified about that before. That has been a commitment from the department, and it will continue to be a commitment. The system has to be ready, and our counties have to be ready. They have to be well-trained. They have to know the system. I do believe the new system, from what I've seen, is much more intuitive than the current system. But that is a decision that we're going to make in partnership with the counties. We're going to get their feedback and make sure that the system is ready to go and that the counties are ready to use it. I want to clear the air about the Shore Modernization Project. It is not unique to the Commonwealth, and it's not an excuse. It irritates me personally when we fall behind, and I have to jump in, and sometimes I jump in personally if I have to move things along. But industry-wide, I think it's something like 70% or 80% of IT projects fail. So it's not unique to Commonwealth government. We've had our issues. We've worked very closely with the Office of Administration to put this vendor on a corrective action plan. We've also been very honest with ourselves about what we're doing internally that may be delaying the project. So I'm not gonna get boxed into saying a specific date for when we deliver, because that's a decision we're going to make in consultation with the counties. Yeah.
And if my memory serves me, there were three iterations of modernization: election night management, lobbying disclosure, and then kind of the voter registration. Do you have that?
Yes, that was kind of the phased okay. approach, yes.
Election night management, is that completed?
Election night returns, we're doing additional testing of that. We're having some problems with sort of the connection between the election management functionality and the election night returns, and we're working through that with the vendor. Some of those are related to security concerns, and we're working with the Office of Administration and the vendor to address those. On the voter registration module, I think this vendor has found out that Pennsylvania is very unique. One of the hurdles we've had is how voters are transferred in Pennsylvania. In Pennsylvania, unlike any other jurisdiction, we have a very rigid process for transferring a record from one county to another. And this is probably because the law is 80 years old. It requires first that the old county reach out to the voter and cancel the voter before the new county can activate the voter in that county. It's not a seamless process, and the vendor's been struggling to kind of, you know, get that logic correct.
Right.
But we're going to continue to work through those issues, and it will it will be a partnership with, and we're not going to stop at 23 counties. That just happened to be the number who volunteered to help us with testing. We certainly want all 67 counties to be involved in that.
So would a recommendation to help advance it sooner, legal change to move away from, at least for the internal transfer, move away from a paper form to an electronic transfer to make it easier for counties to transfer that and actually use the function of the system, of the new system?
Yes, I think it would be a lot easier if that transfer process were seamless and not this two-step process.
Okay.
And it'll be completely auditable. It'll still be auditable, so you're not going to lose anything from an integrity perspective.
All right. So election night management system is being worked out on security concerns. You have voter registration, which you're waiting for deliverables from the vendor, and then you have lobbying disclosure. Have you started work on the lobbying disclosure aspect, or is that, I'm trying to think if that was two or three where that fell in line.
Yeah, so development has been done on lobbying disclosure, but that is, we're focusing on getting the voter registration and election stuff out of the way, done, delivered to the counties before we release the lobbying disclosure.
Okay. Very helpful. Luzerne County, I'll tell you where I'm at with them. I'm at the point where the department probably needs to go in and just take them over until they're capable of operating elections. The fact that we changed the law to increase the number of printed ballots and they ran out of ballots on multiple elections at 9 a.m. is completely inexcusable. I get where your department is at of counties operate elections, we've been like that, but I do want to know if authorized and we funded the operation, would you put people in the ground to make sure that Luzerne County operates its elections to the law?
I think that's a conversation that we'd have to have and not one that we've considered directly operating an elections, election administration in a county.
Okay, because they need help. We heard from one of our colleagues who represents that area, and it's been an ongoing issue in that county getting it right. And we've highlighted numerous issues, turnover, the whole nine yards. But that level cannot continue through any county. And to me, they are kind of a highlight of it needs fixed desperately for those people.
And if I may add, Chairman, I mean, an even bigger concern is if you have that play out in other counties as well, moving forward with this attrition of experienced election administrators throughout the Commonwealth. Hopefully it's not something we'll see elsewhere, but I think in terms of providing the resources and the checklists and whatever we can to assist those election administrators to avoid sometimes very simple clerical and administrative errors, I think will help prevent this from spreading.
Okay. I also find that when we allow county administrators to do one thing at a time, they excel at doing those one things. I find within our current statute, we overlap processes, which means they're trying to do multiple things simultaneously. So as we envision moving forward with changes, trying to create a system that allows them to complete this task and move on to the next task. It lowers their costs, allows them to be more efficient moving forward, and hopefully some of the little mistakes, printing errors and stuff we've seen in the past will go away.
And Chairman, you're exactly right. Having been I frequently say I'm a recovering election administrator, but having worked with them throughout the Commonwealth, that is absolutely a mindset that your attention is laser focused on one aspect of election administration until it then has to pivot to the next aspect of election administration. And it's a real challenge, given the detail-oriented nature of so much of this, to focus broadly on everything you need to do. But I have seen that phenomenon when it comes to election administration that you just described.
Yeah. Last thing I do want to hit on, many people have hit on this licensing.
Last one, Chairman? Is this your last one?
I appreciate the governor's executive order on permitting and licensing, but ultimately people just want their license. They don't want their money back. They just want their license. You go to school to become a nurse, you want to be a nurse. I think they may appreciate getting their money back, but ultimately they want that license to do their job. And a lot of these jobs we've got to fill. We're going to hit on, many colleagues hit that we have nursing students that are going to be graduating. this body, the Senate, will get inundated calls from nurses graduating asking us to expedite their nursing license. So we got a call, and obviously if we call you to expedite their license, someone else is getting knocked back, so then they will call there, and it's just an ongoing thing. So the sooner we get that fixed for timely licensing and permitting, and listen, we may be putting our district offices out of business, but I'd rather have it fixed at the agency end than get those calls, because I know it's something that we can prevent from doing and having to deal with.
So. It is, and the governor, just so you know, the governor has made that abundantly clear to me how important this issue is and how important it is that we address it.
I do. Thank you. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank the gentleman. It's a little bit more than 5 minutes, but you know, we're flexible with our chairman. We appreciate you. And we appreciate all the members and for all of their questions. Mr. Secretary, I do want to echo the sentiments of one of my colleagues. We've known each other for some time now, and what you, particularly in your family, were put through a few years ago in the city of Philadelphia was uncalled for, unpatriotic, but the way that you handled yourself is exactly what a public servant should look like. And, you know, I've said this to you privately, but I want to say publicly that we appreciate your service to the Commonwealth, to this country, and to all of the folks who work with you every day. You know, these budget hearings are an opportunity for our members to ask questions so that we can be good stewards of the taxpayers' resources. But what we don't want is for any of you to think that we do not value the work that you do every single day. This Commonwealth does not work without the workers of this Commonwealth. So we thank you all for your service to the Commonwealth. And thank you, Mr. Secretary, for your service.
Thank you, Chairman.
And with that, that concludes our budget hearing for today. That was painless. And on time, I would like to add. Just want to put that out there that we did that on time. All right, so we're done. We don't have another one today. We'll be back here. We'll be back here tomorrow at 10 a.m. for the Department of Corrections, and then in the afternoon we have transportation. So we'll be back tomorrow with two hearings. So I will see everyone on the floor tomorrow, 10 a.m. Enjoy the rest of your day.